Well, let's talk more about the G20 now. And to discuss some of today's economic data as well, we're joined by Nariman Baravesh. He's chief global economist for IHS Global Insight. He previously served as chief international economist at Standard & Poor's. And according to data compiled by Bloomberg, he is one of the most accurate forecasters of the economy. That makes him one of our Bloomberg best. Nariman, thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Julie.
So let's talk G20. You think the G20 is a fig leaf. Explain what you mean by that.
Well, basically, these statements are so broad and so vague to some extent that they allow everybody, they give cover for everybody to do what they were going to do anyway. So Germans are going to do what they're going to do. The Americans are going to do what they're going to do. So you sort of say, what's the point? It's sort of hard not to be cynical about these, but I think that's what it is. It's the semblance of, oh, yes, everybody's one big happy family, but everybody's going to do what they're going to do anyway.
Well, and in this case, the U.S. is going to spend its way to growth or try to, and Europe's going to try and cut its way to avoiding the poorhouse, one could say. I mean, is there a place, though, for the balancing act that the statement, the consensus statement, seems to imply?
Well, it's a very good question. I think some countries in Europe really don't have a choice. Greece, for example, it really doesn't have a choice. It needs to contract to have that sort of market credibility about its austerity package and so on. Germany, on the other hand, has a lot of leeway. It doesn't have quite the budget problems the rest of Europe does. So you have to wonder, why are they contracting? Why are they so sort of fiscally tight, if you will, at this point where Europe's very fragile? So I think there's a lot of room to maneuver here for the Germans. So the concern is, why are they being so tough? Is it just to set a good example? I think the answer is probably. And I think that's why they're so adamant about it, is they don't want to give an excuse for the likes of Greece and Spain and so forth, not to do what they have to do.
Nariman, what did China get out of the meeting?
Well, I think it was interesting. Probably the best thing China got out was it really was very low on the agenda in terms of the exchange rate. So it was rather than be a point of contention, or major point of contention, I should say, it was a fairly minor point of contention. It was the argument was between the Americans and the Europeans rather than, say, the Americans and the Chinese.
Nariman, I want to turn to the U.S. economy. We got some numbers out today, of course, on personal income and spending. Spending up 0.2%. Are these the numbers that we should be seeing at this stage of a recovery?
Well, of course not. The hope is that things should be stronger. But the good news, if you will, two pieces of good news. One is consumers are spending, not at a gangbusters rate, but spending. And they're also saving. So they're sort of doing a bit of a balancing act. But very important and very good news from today's release and also the GDP numbers that came out on Friday is that the income side of the economy is actually growing faster than the expenditure side. Right. That's good news. It sets the stage for further spending going forward. You want it that way rather than the opposite. So that's actually a good early read on the fact that this recovery is going to continue.
But Nariman, is it fair to say that at this point that consumer spending is not going to be the engine that's going to jumpstart this economy?
You're absolutely right about that. But it is setting the foundation, and a pretty solid foundation. But the real engines of growth right now actually are capital spending on equipment and, to a somewhat lesser extent, exports. Those are the true engines, if you will. Those are what are making the difference in terms of going forward.
Well, to bring it and to link it up with what one of the themes of the G20, I mean, what do you think of this sort of spending to growth strategy, since it doesn't seem to be bearing a whole lot of fruit thus far, at least not on the consumer spending front?
Again, a good question. I think really, if sort of dig deep as to what's the argument about, the argument is, do you tighten fiscal policy now, or do you tighten it later when you feel more confident of the recovery? And I think the Americans are saying later because we're still not sure of the recovery, and the Europeans are saying now because that somehow or other creates a sense of credibility, if you will. And I think that's the argument.
Right, but Nariman, in about our last 45 seconds, these jobless numbers are still a cause for concern. Even though we see some bright spots and we see some dark spots in these economic data that we're all trying to sift through, that unemployment number being still 10%, near 10%, that's got to be a cause for concern going forward.
I completely agree with you. It's going to come down very slowly. The good news is we think the private sector will have added 120,000 jobs in June. The not-so-good news is because the census workers are leaving, they're done, the headline number will actually be a negative. could be down 100,000. So it's going to be a bit of a mixed story. But the good news will be that the private sector is creating jobs.
All right, Nariman, unfortunately, we're out of time. Nariman Baravash is a chief economist at IHS Global Insight. Nariman, thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure.